our last video's goal was to show how King Matthias used the religious and political instability of the Holy Roman Empire to strengthen his own kingdom and influence. In this video, we would like to show you how he treated the ever-growing threat, which was the Ottoman Empire, his plans about making a lasting dynasty, and of what remained from his legacy after his death. Matthias's father, John Hunyadi's legend, played a huge role in his election for the crown. John was famous for his relentless fights against the Ottoman forces, which earned him the title Patriarch Christi from the Pope, meaning the champion of Christ. Matthias had a great legacy to grow up to, since Europe expected him to continue his father's cause. Rating in his campaigns, he received large sums of gold from the Vatican, but he, however, used it to fuel his expansions towards the west. Many claim that he overlooked the Ottoman threat, which led to the kingdom to ruin for the next centuries after his death. Others believe that he sought to be the Holy Roman Emperor for this exact reason, to unite Europe under one banner against the Ottoman aggression. We can be certain, however, it is more plausible that he looked at the whole situation with a pragmatic mind. He knew that Hungary is incapable of waging a years-long war on the Balkans, which would have exhausted the kingdom both financially and in manpower. For this reason, he tried to keep the status quo on the south with peace treaties and by reinforcing the frontier with two chains of fortresses. His battles were mostly defensive, and he rarely took the role of the aggressor. Since the start of his rule, the Ottoman Empire gloomed over the kingdom. He was barely crowned when Lazarus Brankovic, Serbian despot, died without an heir. The Sultan Mehmed II used the power vacuum left by Lazarus' departure to conquer his kingdom. From the August of 1458 to 59, the Serbian castles fell under his rule, and with Smederevo's fall in June, the whole country was conquered. The next few years were spent in relative peace on the southern border, since Mehmed focused on bringing the southwestern parts of the Balkan into his empire. This lasted up until 1461, when the voivode of Wallachia and vassal of Matthias, Vlad Tepes, refused to pay tribute to the Sultan. The retaliation came in the spring of the next year. Even with the Hungarian auxiliary troops, Vlad's army was severely outnumbered. He avoided open confrontation and instead used guerrilla strikes and scorched earth tactics while he retreated to his capital, Dragovista. To break the remaining spirit of the invader army, Vlad put thousands of severed Ottoman heads outside his city. The underfed army, upon seeing the fate of their late comrades, lost all willingness to fight and retreated without a siege. Mehmed failed to defeat Vlad, however, he gifted the unconquered country to Vlad's brother, the Ottoman sympathizer Radu. Radu, with the Sultan's blessing, assaulted Vlad's fortress, who was forced to flee to Transylvania to meet Matthias. Unfortunately for him, Radu already made a deal with the Hungarian king. In addition to paying the Sultan's tribute, he also acknowledged Hungary's rule over his voivodeship and became Matthias's vassal in the September of 1462. By Vlad was imprisoned at the castle of Visegrad. Similar reasons led the Sultan to Upper Bosnia in the spring of next year, since Stephen Tomasevich, King of Bosnia, also refused to pay tribute to him. Stephen hoped for the aid of the Mantovan Congress, which was a loose alliance against the Ottomans, organized by Pope Pius II. However, there were huge tensions inside the Congress, mainly because of King Matthias and Emperor Frederick's rivalry. When the Congress finally managed to send help to Bosnia, the Ottomans already claimed Jajce as the capital. Stephen was imprisoned and executed, and the whole country became part of the Ottoman Empire. Jajce was not only a locally important fortress, but it had a Europe-wide importance. With its fall, it became a springboard for the Ottoman forces to pillage, not just in Hungary, but in Croatia, Austria and Venice as well. To prevent this, Matthias joined a military alliance with the Venetian Republic in September 1463. Their plan was to attack from two directions. Matthias led the offense through the newly conquered Bosnia, while Venice did the same on the Peloponnese. The king himself led the siege of Jajce and took the city by October, but Bey Yusuf Aram and his janissaries still held the citadel for two more months. The Bey and his men, fearing the wrath of Mehmed, even joined the ranks of Matthias. With the capital under Hungarian control, the rest of Upper Bosnia was won by relative ease. The king made the Beynate out of it, and appointed Imre Sopoy to govern and protect the area. Pope Pius, seeing the success of Matthias, decided to order a crusade. In his plans, Hungary and Venice would have continued the campaigns they started, while the United Christian Army joined Skanderbeg, who led the fight for the Albanian independence. A smaller army mobilized towards Albania, but the start of the crusade was never ordered, because the Pope died in the August of 1464. Mehmed, in response for the attack of Matthias, tried to capture Jajce back. However, the Hungarian forces withstood the siege, and the Sultan's army left at August 22. They likely broke the siege because of the news about Matthias's forces. The 23,000-strong Hungarian army, aided by 7,000 crusaders, started to mobilize towards the south. The king split his army into two and ordered Sopoy to capture Srebrenik, while he marched towards Vornik. By the October, the Baron successfully completed his mission and joined forces with the king. They, however, were also forced to withdraw since Grand Commander Mahmud was on his way to lead the siege. The Sultan and the king reached a common truce. They divided Bosnia under the current status quo with the addition of free passage for the Ottomans if they wished to raid in the neighboring countries. Thanks to this agreement, Matthias focused on the Western wars in relative safety, and apart from a few deceptions, the kingdom only suffered from minor raiding. These truce, however, didn't mean stopping the fights altogether. Informed on auxiliary troops, Matthias still supported other rulers, like his vassal, Stephen the Great of Moldova, when in the January of 75, he scored a great victory against the Ottoman army with the help of Balázs Magyar at Vaslui. The campaign of Justica Stephen Bathory also started from Moldova, and he led it through to Valachia in 76, where he overthrew Voivod Bazarab III, who seized the throne from Bradu. In his place, he lifted Vlad Tepes to rule again, but as soon as the Justica's army left the voivodeship, Vlad was killed, and his head was sent to Mehmed, and Bazarab ruled again. The kingdom managed to avoid larger skirmishes until 1479. In October, a large raiding party led by Isabey swept through the king's lands, taking both treasures and captives for slaves. Matthias was occupied with conquering Austria at the time, but he could not stand idle by an aggression to his grave. The king mobilized his army and sent his best generals against the Bey. The battle took place at Bresfield, Transylvania, on the 13th of October, when the arriving army forced the camping raiders into an open battle. We don't know the exact numbers of the armies, but it is estimated between 15 and 20,000 strong for both sides. Since the Bey's goal was to pillage the area, his army lacked the professional elite units like the janissaries, so the bulk of his army consisted of irregular troops, like the light cavalry Akinci and the light footmen Asabs. He divided his forces into three columns, him leading the center, while Bey Ali Kocha commanded his left flank and Marko Csugnu his right. The Hungarian army mirrored his movement. Justica Bathory, as chief commander, took the lead of the center column. Paul Kinishi protected his right with heavy cavalry, while the Serbian voivode of George Pankovic commanded the left. The battle started out badly for the Hungarians, since the horse of Bathory stumbled at the first sword crash, throwing its commander to the ground. Using this quick panic, Kinishi charged at the center and started to surround the Justica. Pankovic couldn't take him, since he was evenly matched with the men of Marko Csugnu, and Kinishi's men were blocked by Ali's troops. The tide of the battle changed when Kinishi withdrew his knights and lined up for a charge. Alegre knew that his Achaeans had no chance at stopping an attack like this, and fled the battlefield, leaving his men behind. His troops were massacred man by man without a commander, by Kinichi threw himself in the middle of the fight. This movement was recorded by Dolkinid, Matthias' sister brother, who wrote the poem. All Kinichi takes swords in both hands, and with the roar of a lion, bathes with blood. Wherever he charges, unrelenting, but he finds, he storms it, and in a wide room he carries out a great canoe and massacre. By crushing the Ottoman's left leg, he managed to regroup the battery, who was still in danger, thanks to ice basin run. But when the Hungarian reinforcements arrived, he was fatally wounded and had to be supported out of the battlefield. The Ottoman center was left without command, quickly collapsed and started to flee. As a result, the right leg did the same. The disoriented raiders were chased down by the royal horsemen and were cut down to the last man. The retaliation continues. In 1480, the Sultan's army attacked Matthias' father-in-law, Ferdinand, King of Naples, and captured the city of Otranto. The king sent Balázs Magyar to recapture the city, while the Black Army started an offensive in South Bosnia, Kinizsi in Serbia, while the Moldovan army of Stephen did the same in Wallachia. Otranto was liberated by 1481, and Kinizsi pushed further, scoring great victories on Sajarevo and Smederevo. This was around the time when Mehmed died and his son, Bayezid II, succeeded him. The new Sultan negotiated peace with Matthias and signed a 5-year treaty in 1483, which they extended in 1488. With this treaty, the Ottoman race stopped until the death of Matthias. In addition to taking the title of Holy Roman Emperor, Matthias had another grand plan, founding a dynasty. Even after proving himself as a great politician and military commander, he was still looked down by the leaders of Europe because of his family was relatively low-born compared to their hundreds of years of legacy. He managed to marry Catherine, daughter of George Podjebrad, King of Bohemia, in the very beginning of his rule. However, the queen died shortly after in childbirth, along with the royal heir. The king immediately looked for new spouses, but this, however, did not meant giving up the company of ladies. He was notorious, even in his time, about eyeing the other sex, which got him trouble numerous times, since their citizens didn't take kindly the king's interest in their daughters and wives. His adventures stopped in 1470, when at the Congress of Vienna met Barbara Edelbrock, daughter of a wealthy Austrian citizen. They immediately bonded, and the king even brought her back to Buda. Their son, John Corvinus, was born out of wedlock in 1473, but both him and his mother was forced to leave the palace in 1475, and Ferdinand of Aragon offered his daughter, Beatrix, to the king. Matthias married Beatrix in 1476, and the relationship initially bloomed. She was from one of the most illustrious houses of Europe, and she also had royal ancestors from House Arpad, founders of Hungary, which solidified Matthias' dynastic ambitions. She, however, did not only impress the king with her ancestry and beauty, but also with her wits. As a Neapolitan, she played a large role in that Hungary was the first country outside of Italy to really embrace the Renaissance. Artistic and intellectual life flourished in the kingdom. The royal court was filled with artists and humanists from Italia, where numerous Hungarian talents were sent there to study and refine their skills. This was the time when the works of John Turozzi, Antonio Bonfini, Pietro Ranzano were written, all of which recorded the Hungarian history, while Andrew Hess funded his printing press in Buda, first in the country. To aid the scientific advancements, the king established the University of Bratislava, where he employed scholars all over Europe. Matthias was also a great patron of art. He welcomed the Jewish craftsmen who were exiled from Sicily and Spain, but also invited painters and sculptors from Italy. He financed the most influential humanist poet in the country, Janus Pannonius, and his friends Gelato Marzio. He had nothing to be ashamed of in the regards of music as well. his royal conductor instructed the papal orchestra before, and contemporary composers flocked to the palace. He had many architectural projects as well. Both castles of Buda and Visegrad were renovated and expanded with Renaissance additions. He even commissioned Leonardo da Vinci to paint him a Madonna. The castles of the southern frontier were updated by the military engineer Aristotele Fioravanti, while the Franciscan and Polite monks were gifted with monasteries and churches built in the late Gothic and Renaissance styles. His greatest heritage, however, was the Biblioteca Corvina, the royal library, only rivaled by the papal archives of the time. It consisted around 3,000 codexes, which are called Corvinus after the king. The heavily ornamented books held knowledge from all aspects of the Renaissance interest, like theology, history, science, but also contained writings from the antiquity. Despite the cultural impact of the marriage with Beatrice, the wedlock couldn't deliver on its most important promise. The dynasty plans of Matthias were shattered when they realized that Beatrice could not bear a child. From 1479, most of his focus was on ensuring the succession of John Corvinus, his illegitimate son. The king legitimized him by the Pope and donated him many castles, cities and villages, by giving him titles of count and prince. Thanks to this, John was the largest landowner when Matthias passed away. In addition to giving huge lands to John, Matthias also married him to Bianca Maria Sforza, Princess of Milano, who, like Beatrice, was also a descendant of House Arpad. Even after all his measures, Matthias still wasn't sure in the succession of John. By 1489, his health was rapidly declining, which in his despair made him negotiate with his archenemy, Frederick III. Matthias would have granted the Hungarian throne to Frederick's son, Maximilian, and would give the emperor back Styria and Carinthia if Frederick made John king of Croatia and Bosnia. The deal, however, didn't happen because Frederick insisted on having Lower Austria, which Matthias would not give. After a long sickness, Matthias Corvinus died at the 6th of April, 1490. His body was laid to rest at the St. Stephen Cathedral in Alba Regia, burial grounds of the Hungarian kings. After his death, all of his peers manifested themselves. The nobles seized all supports toward John and started to put behind the Bohemian Vladislav and his brother, the Polish John Albert. Beatrice, who wished to remain queen, also supported Vladislav in exchange for marriage. Finally, when the Diet voted in the favor of the Bohemian, he immediately invalidated the wedlock. The late queen, without any income or support, was forced to move back to Italy. But fate was no more gracious to John either. In the name of Vladislav, Ginigi and Bathory defeated him at Bolfield. They made him renounce his claim for the throne and even had to carry the holy crown to Vladislav during his coronation. His marriage was no longer beneficial to the Sforza family, so they invalidated the wedlock with the Pope, the wedded Bianca to Emperor Maximilian. John married again to Beatrice Fargapan, who gave him 3 children. He managed to make peace with Vladislav and even became the Ban of Slavonia. He waged war against the Ottoman with relative success. However, he was gravely wounded in a battle with a raiding army and died shortly after in 1494. Both of his sons died young the next year, and with his daughter's death in 1508, the lineage of Matthias perished with her. Matthias's prized soldiers, the Black Army, was disbanded in 1493 and was degenerated into raiders. Their amok had to be stopped by their late leaders, Ginigi and Bathory, who crushed the criminal gang. Vladislav was unable to get a firm grip on his rule. Threatened by Emperor Maximilian, he gave back the Austrian territories and left the kingdom in a weakened state. After his death, his son, Vladislav II, was defeated and killed at Mohacs in 1526 by the Ottoman army, which opened the way to the capital for the invaders. Most of the buildings commissioned by Matthias were destroyed, including the palaces of Buda and Visegrad, along with most of the royal library. With the death of King Matthias, everything he worked for crumbled into the dust, his works of art lost, his dynasty extinct, a and his weakened kingdom became exposed to the whims of the Ottoman Empire for 150 years. Aye, this is the end of our series about Matthias Corvinus. We hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. We are very sorry about that this took that amount of time to finish. Videos like this takes a lot of work in research, translation and editing, which we could not find the time in the best. We, however, read your comments and we are very thankful for your patience and support. We hope to make more videos like this in the future, and if you would like to see them as well, please consider subscribing. Thank you again for sticking with us, and until next time, we wish you well.